But is there any evidence that tactically, because what you have to do is to consider the counter argument as well, because the question is how far do you agree with the view? Is there any evidence that that there wasn't tactically a revolution in the art of warfare? So I'm going to have another paragraph on tactics. Maybe there's not really a revolution. Now, is there anything in the sources that suggests that? Well, source 9 says that the army wasn't the most advanced and eager in new tactical ideas. So I'll bring that in there. Source 9, not eager in tactical ideas. But that's about it, really, in terms of what the sources suggest, in terms of there not really being a revolution tactically. So I'll go back and look at my notes. Well, tactically, what have we got for the Battle of the Somme? Tactics bad. The men were weighed down by 30 kilos of equipment. The offensives across no man's land resulted in huge casualties. Slowly walking across no man's land. The wire wasn't destroyed by the barrage. It just cut British telephone cables. Only 6 miles of territory gained in 5 months of the Somme. In 5 months of the whole battle. So, okay, that's pretty bad. But the question is revolution. So does it get any better? Well, Passchendaele, it's another grueling battle that lasts for months and the first day objectives aren't achieved. So, yeah, I think tactically there's still, you know, I've written the bombardment turned the ground into a swamp. So, tactically they're still using, plus, in 1917, there's still a bombardment followed by an offensive, which is, you know, very similar to the Somme. So I'll write that. In 1918, what have we got tactically? Well, okay, the tactics are a bit more flexible, but the Allies suffer heavier casualties than the Germans. 264,383 casualties between the 21st of August and the 11th of November. It means a daily loss rate of 3,645 men on average. Well, that's a higher rate of casualties than at Somme or at Passchendaele. So that would sort of seem to suggest that tactically there's not an enormous revolution if they're still suffering heavy losses, if it's still essentially an attritional war. So we'll say something about that as well. 1918 is still attritional tactics, wearing the enemy down. There's still high casualty rates. So, I've got paragraph for and against the view that there was a revolution in the art of warfare in terms of tactics. Now, let's do technology. Well, first of all, let's look at the positives for technology. Source 8 clearly says that, yeah, there's a revolution in terms of technology. It talks about tanks, mechanical transport. Source 8, let's write that down. Mechanical transport. He talks about trench mortars, gas, portable machine guns. Yeah, that's what he talks about. And even Source 9 says furthest ahead in tank development. Now, what have I got from my own knowledge that I can integrate with that? In terms of there being progress, in terms of there being a revolution. Well, there are machine guns, 1916, at the Somme. If you remember, when we looked at weapons recently, there were very few machine guns in 1914, but there were more from 1916 onwards. We've got, the men had hand grenades, rifles, planes are being used for reconnaissance. Tanks were used, but not to much effect. But, you know, first use of tanks, in 1916. Planes used for reconnaissance in 1916. In 1917, what have we got? Technology. More guns and shells than used at the Somme. It's not really a revolution, is it? Technology in terms of 1918, new tanks, Mark V tanks. 1918, Mark V tanks. We've got mustard gas shells, mustard gas. New rifle grenades. There's attacks by massed aircraft. Attacks by massed aircraft. There's sound ranging being used. Okay, there's quite a lot there then. There's quite a lot of other evidence that supports the evidence of source A. But is there evidence that challenges this view, that there wasn't a revolution in terms of technology? Well, none of the sources suggest it really. So let's have a look at our own knowledge. 1916, in terms of technology, was there a revolution? Well, the telephone cables were likely to have been cut by the shelling, so it was difficult to communicate. There was a lack of preparation for gas attacks. Tanks didn't make much impact. Okay, so that's not really revolutionary, is it? But let's see if it progressed. In terms of technology, still using horses at Passchendaele. Well, okay, let's say something about this. That tanks were, you know, pretty ineffective at the Somme and Passchendaele. And horses were still used at Passchendaele. Some horses drowned in the mud at Passchendaele. And what have we got for 1918? In terms of technology, I haven't got anything in terms of, you know, poor use of technology in 1918. So, maybe there's a little bit there, a little bit of sort of counter-argument to there not being a revolution in the art form in terms of technology. Finally, we're going to talk about leadership, because Source 9 suggests leadership that there wasn't a revolution. There's no revolution, Source 9. It says that the officers are, quote, dull and inflexible and standing in the way. What's the quote? Standing in the way of real change. So, what do we know? Is there anything from our own knowledge that backs that up? Well, in terms of leadership at the Somme, there seems to be, I've written down here, that there seems to be an indifference by officers to huge casualties. They clung to the hope of using cavalry and frontal attacks by the infantry. General Rawlinson didn't tell General Haig that the wire hadn't been cut by the bombardment of the Somme offensive. Haig didn't like having his plans criticised. Haig accepted that on the first day of the Somme, 60,000 casualties and 20,000 deaths was likely to happen. So in terms of leadership, well, it's hardly revolutionary, isn't it? There seems to be an acceptance in 1916 of heavy losses. And you know, due to the attritional nature of the war. And there seems to be, you know, sort of clinging, you know, the backing up this idea, standing in the way of real change, not eager for new tactical ideas, this still desire to use cavalry. That there also seems to be a sort of hesitation, more than a hesitation, an unwillingness to criticize senior officers. What have we got from 1917? Well, 1917, at Passchendaele, we've got 320,000 Allied soldiers lost and only 5 miles gained. I've written down that there was a pointless focus on Passchendaele. It was a little village that didn't have any strategic objectives, really, but Haig seemed to focus on it. The Prime Minister, Lloyd George, thought Haig was indifferent to human losses. And there was a difference, a disagreement amongst leaders of strategy. So there's no, doesn't seem to be much of a revolution between 1916 and 1917. Bearing in mind that the Somme was the worst military disaster that Britain had ever suffered, if ever there was an impetus for a revolution, surely that would have been it. But there doesn't seem to have been one between 1916 and 17. So we can say in 1917, again, similar sort of approach by leadership. The desire to use horses. The pointless strategic objectives. And the seeming, the apparent indifference to huge losses. All that stuff does seem to support the view of Source 9 that the leadership were dull, inflexible, stood in the way of change, lessons weren't acted on. So it doesn't seem to be much of a change between 1916 and 1917. Where are my notes about 1918 in terms of leaders? Now, I've written down, was victory more due to Bulgarian, Austrian and Ottoman surrender? Or the German, Ludendorff, seeking peace terms in September? Or was victory more due to the decline in morale of Germany after the successes of the spring offensives, the German spring offensive, had been lost? Or was victory more due to a dent in German morale after the arrival of fresh American soldiers? Well, none of that is about British leaders, which is what we're talking about. So I haven't been able to find any evidence of bad British leadership, really, in 1918. But I have got a little bit of evidence here for improved British leadership in 1918. Apparently there was an integrated command structure, i.e. a combined French and English control under the French Marshal Foch. And Haig was more prepared to let commanders use initiative. Some of you said that in your essay. So we'll say something over here about, on the positive side for leadership, we can say that there is some evidence in 1918 of some change, i.e. more prepared to let commanders use initiative, but perhaps you couldn't, perhaps not revolutionary. Okay, so done quite a bit there, gone through all the sources, squeezed as much as we can out of all the sources, gone through my notes that we made in class when we looked at Somme and Passchendaele and the 100 Days Offensives, tried to integrate them. We've got some evidence for the view and some evidence against the view. We've got some themes that we can talk about, tactics, technology and leadership. I think we're ready to write it now.